questions to Claire, and of course you are going to have the chance to ask her. But I want to also invite the panelists, please, Scott, Nicole, Dushan, and Frederick, join us. This is officially a data science cafe, a data science salon. Basically, the first one was about GDPR. Very interesting, your final comment.
Everyone expects me to know what they should do about GDPR, and I really don't.
No, indeed, it was interesting the conversation that we have in the first volume of the data science salon, because it was exactly about trying to join both conversations. And it's still a long path in the way, but it's definitely interesting. So, why are we having a panelist? Basically, we are going to let everybody to introduce themselves, and then let open that you could ask the questions that you want. If there are no questions, I'm going to ask the questions regarding the different profiles. But the most important thing when we want to move from the talking to doing is really closing these gaps, because wonderful presentation, both of you, Rania and Claire, thanks. But also it's like, okay, how it applies to me? There are certain fears that you could have, and what we want to bring is the different perspective. In a few seconds, they are going to introduce themselves, and you will see that the panel is very diverse. We'll bring different perspectives, and please feel free to ask, so the panelists could respond to your questions and your concerns about how bringing both worlds together. So we could start maybe with Frederick.
Okay, so hello everybody, my name is Frederick. I'm supposed to do a short introduction.
Very short introduction about you, exactly. And why
I'm here, basically.
Exactly.
Yes. So, yes, I'm also one of the trained mathematicians here. I used to work in financial services. I had a CIO kind of role. The last 2 years I worked in a social business in Austria, a startup. And the last 3 months, I'm on a deep dive into data science. And the reason I'm invited here today is I have participated in such a hackathon for social good. And I can give a short summary perhaps right now or later. Yeah?
Maybe during the conversation. And if the questions do not arise, I will ask you directly.
Right.
Definitely.
So, yes, I have been in Berlin in the data. Brilliant, our brothers and sisters up there, they have like launched a similar initiative a couple years ago, and the 2018 edition of the Social Good Hackathon was in May, and I was participating as a data diver, and I'm happy to explain a little bit more how this works afterwards.
Hi, yeah, my name is Scott Frerig. Why am I on the panel? A quick introduction. I have worked in a number of startups as well as large enterprises that have used data and information to generate profits in the private sector as well as to try to generate some particular social good. I guess my initial comment would be that data is not new, but the democratization of techniques is relatively new. Data has been used for a long time in the scientific software field. And I'm a member of this group, and Mari asked me to participate in the panel, so I guess that's really why I'm here. I have a couple, I have some very specific reactions, comments to Claire when we get to it after we've made our introductions.
Of course. Yeah, mainly Scott has a very interesting experience in the private sector, and right now he's focusing also in working with NGOs, have a great experience to share there. Well, you know Claire?
I'm Nicole Blackstone. I'm working for ESSE Foundation, or with ESSE Foundation actually. And there I'm leading the topic of social innovation. And about like 1.5 years ago now, I was at a conference in San Francisco and at Stanford. And there I bumped into Teradata. And that's how like a long journey started on that ended in a datathon that was like 2 months ago. So I think that's why I'm at this panel.
Yeah, she has very interesting insights that we share by email, and of course we are going to talk about it during the panel. And finally, but not least, Dushan.
Thank you for having me. Yeah, so my name is Dushan. I am here on behalf of Impact Hub Vienna community. Impact Hub is a global association and a community of 100 co-working spaces, incubators, accelerators, primarily for social entrepreneurs and NGO leaders that are trying to make a positive impact on society or for the environment. And yeah, I'm here to speak on behalf of our community of 600 such social innovators and entrepreneurs that we have here in Vienna. And yeah, we're kind of on the most in the early stage side of things. So I'm happy to share a bit of that perspective and kind of how that works with data.
So basically, as you see, the panel is very diverse and bringing different perspectives from different areas. Some are coming from more technical backgrounds, there are others that are coming from the social or NGO side. So basically, we are going to open, so you could ask the questions. The panelists could participate depending on the questions, up to you. And if there are no questions, don't worry, I have questions prepared in any case. But I prefer that you bring your own questions, okay? So, who wants to start? Yes, please.
Yeah, well, the topic I like to raise in any kind of these meetings is how are we going to build some kind of really sustainable data processing infrastructure? Because the problem I'm bumping into for years now is that we have a tsunami of raw data, especially Earth observation data, terabytes of raw data, and we have lots of projects who have really interesting ideas what to do with it. I've been with many hackathons and cool ideas, hundreds of ideas. There are hundreds of projects, but all of them I know are dead already for one simple reason, and that is processing data on a global scale is really complicated. It needs really some financing, and the second problem, it needs really long-term financing. Yeah, because what's happening at the moment is we have hundreds of excellent projects, yeah, but with huge data sets like satellite data, it makes sense to process them once on a global scale and then share the data between different projects. And I don't see that happening right now.
I think one possible answer is that there's no one global solution for all Earth observation data. There are specific narrow domains where this stuff has been done for 20 years. And you know, now that sort of data science has become a bit of a buzzword as well as understood in larger contexts, if you look at seismological data, something that I know a lot about, there is a consortium that's been in existence for over 20 years. It's called the Incorporated Research Institutions in Seismology. And basically, they are research institutions in 125 countries that have agreed they're going to share their seismological data. For earthquakes happen all the time. We don't generally understand them. But the data can be used in a post-processing format. What I really wanted to make a point about is, yes, you're right. We need continued funding. This was something that actually the U.S. did well. The National Science Foundation supports this data management consortium, and they're still collecting data. And I have colleagues that are going to Africa next month to set up networks, and another one in Bishkek. And this data is being collected so that it can be continued to be analyzed. But it's not a, what are we going to do with the flood of data coming from Earth observation satellites without a specific need? It's a very particular area, and private sector and governments need to have a role of long-term support. And for the mathematicians, turns out people really don't understand how the Earth works still. And you know, the holy grail of seismology, something I know something about, is early warning. There's still no early warning, you know, for earthquakes. And so that data still needs to be collected so that we can figure out how to give people 2 minutes worth of warning before the damaging waves happen. So, my partial answer to you is that it is being done in sort of narrow fields, but then there's an interested group of people that are really interested in that area, and somebody has to take the lead in long-term funding.
Completely agree about funding. I mean, I think, you know, if you compare the in private and public sector investments in this, they just, you know, they're nowhere close, and if governments want this stuff in the end, they're going to have to invest in it. So, I think that's, you know, some of them are more, but they're still arguably not enough to realize the sort of potential benefits that they could. I mean, I do think on, I think your point about infrastructure is really important. One of the things that we have been involved in recently is the launch of something called the Africa Regional Data Cube, which a data cube, for those who don't know, is a particular way of organizing and processing, kind of pre-processing satellite data so that it can be more used. And this is the interesting thing here is this is data which was already open. So the sort of difficulty comes not between open and closed, which is still an issue that has to be think of, but even once it's open, the governments in particular who we're working with weren't using it, weren't able to use it because it was too difficult to require too much infrastructure, too much capacity, too much technical inputs to process. So the data cube just reduces some of those barriers to using that data, and it provides you with sort of layers of satellite data going back, in this case, 17 years. I agree, I think there will be different things, and there is a school of thought in the UN, for example, which sometimes kind of thinks that that we need to have one central big platform, and that, you know, there are people, I think, who would love to answer your question with a kind of, let's just build the sort of one platform to rule them all approach. And I kind of, I don't know, I always get, when a field is so new, I always feel a little bit wary of that, because it just feels like we probably still haven't done experimenting. Mm. We need to experiment at a bigger scale, like with the data cube, but I still think we probably want to let a few different things evolve before we know which is really going to be the solution, if indeed there ever is one solution.
Yeah, I would go further than that. I don't think a global service, one global centralized database that everybody accesses will ever be the solution in any field, but that's my opinion.
I don't think that there will ever be one single solution. I think that the question is, who is taking responsibility for getting all the NGOs together?
Yeah.
Because what we really need to do, all the NGOs have lack of money. So what would make sense is to really take the big ones like WWF and so together and UNO and build one, start dealing with one infrastructure. Because if everybody without any money starts to build something tiny and little, it will never scale.
Definitely, that's the reason why the sustainable partnership was created.
Yeah.
And it's part of creating the ecosystem.
I'd like to add something. I'm not sure, and I'm not part of this, but again, have you ever heard of the Data Market Austria?
Yes. Yes, I'm not on the mailing list.
You're on the mailing list, okay? Mm-hmm. Because I think they kind of try what you do. They try a distributed data collection and giving the ability for you to get the data in a processed way, and you can even define how you want the data to be pre-processed for you, so you can use it. And it doesn't matter if it's like data from Africa or from Europe or from wherever. So I think that's one smart approach that could work, but still, that's not NGO-driven. Or
I'm a potential data provider, and I don't know how I'm supposed to provide data, but it's a different topic.
Thanks for bringing it. Just in case for the audience, Data Market Austria is an initiative that is starting the, it has probably, correct me if I'm wrong, 2 years working on, but it's starting officially during this month. And of course, it's still developing with Shoma Mal. We will see exactly how it's going to evolve, but it's a very great example.
Yeah, and sorry, because you asked to provide, how to provide data, and also trying to provide data, and they also fund people who provide data. So
yeah, I think the interesting with NGOs is to make it opposite side, to have a market where people can join together to make they process data, open data. Because if I have 10 customers who pay me the data processing and want to have the data open, I can process the data. I would like to don't get in this commercial area where I have one data set pre-processed and then ask the highest price for it, because it will be too expensive for the NGOs. No NGOs will really buy data.
I have a question to all of the panelists. What I would find interesting is, what do you think is the next step necessary to come to these goals? Because when we talk about like public funding in terms of like Silicon Valley style, like billions of dollars to create social impact and social startups and stuff like this. I see this like 5-10 years ago. So what would be your next step that we can come to this place at some point? Maybe that the public or some other funding scheme, maybe there are some alternatives, but I don't see something like half a year perspective coming to us and telling like, oh, you want to help people coming out of poverty, we give you 2 million and let's see what happens. So yeah, maybe it would be interesting from all kinds of perspectives.
I can start. I don't have the complete answer, and in particular the funding part. But like one of the things that we have the impression when trying to organize these initiatives is that one part of the equation is that many people that might profit from these techniques, data science, machine learning, artificial intelligence, in all these NGOs, social business, or whatever, they still don't know how this works, what this is. So. Like our little part that we try to play here is some sort of get these people to know what's possible. That's not answering the funding question, but other questions, but just like one part of the puzzle is trying to get people to understand what these potentials are, so we can just start to use them.
Yeah, I can share my 2 cents. So, I mean, we work with a lot with the early stage social entrepreneurs, right? So people that want to build up organizations or social business companies that are trying to tackle a challenge. And just this week, I was actually in Croatia discussing the new plan coming from the European Commission on financial instruments for funding social change on European level, right? And I think that one conclusion that everyone of us attending the meeting agreed was that financial instruments have to come with capacity building. You know, so the thing is that the way that I see data, except for the cases where data is a solution, right, or kind of having data or being able to process data, is that data is a tool that you can get or kind of a weapon. You know, even though that's probably not the best analogy for this topic, that you can provide to these people leading such organizations that they can use to kind of get to scale their impact and try to be more effective in what they do. Yeah? So in that sense, I think that the question of how do we scale solutions, that's a pretty complicated question. I think that just funding probably wouldn't help. I've had a lot of cases where really good-hearted people would come and say, I have it all figured out, I just need money, so just connect me with an investor and I need, I don't know, a couple of million to solve this. But, you know, things don't work that way, so it's a much kind of longer process. That's kind of from the very starting or early stage point.
I can only agree to like both statements, because when working with NGOs, maybe big or small ones, they often don't have like in the awareness that they have a lot of data that they can work with actually, and that could help their efficiency or other topics. And then apart from the awareness, the capacity of like working with that data is totally missing. And I'm not even talking about like real data science or something like that, but like normal statistics, as probably you would call it, I don't know. I think that it's a lot on like what, as Dusan said, on capacity building, of building up the awareness in the organizations, and then coming with some funding, like smart funding that gives the organizations like also the freedom of thinking of it actually, because a lot of them are very stuck in their daily, they're like kind of underfunded already, so they're stuck in their daily operations, and then you give them another task and they're like overwhelmed by what's going on or the questions that they have to ask if it comes to the data. Something actually that we experienced in the data. I'm talking from experience.
No, I completely agree. I mean, I think, you know, it's never, most problems are never just need money. You know, you always need money and a whole load of other capacity and all the whole load of other things. But I think that's particularly true of data, because partly in the sort of scale of things that we care about in the development sector, at least, the amounts of money that we're talking about for data are actually relatively small. You know, when you think about the costs of eradicating malaria or vaccinating every child against polio or something, actually the amounts of money that you need to make a really significant difference to your data systems and your infrastructure compared with those kind of programs is tiny. Mm-hmm. So we're not talking about so much money, but we are talking about very big requirements and new requirements in terms of technical infrastructure, physical infrastructure, the broadband and the wires and the, you know, storage and all of those things, and the technical capacity, which is the kind of new bit. So I think, you know, none of these problems are ever just about money, and that's particularly true when you're innovative. But that's not to say that money isn't important, because it certainly is.
I would just comment on a few things that I saw here. Ryan gave the example of using relatively simple satellite data, using a proxy, metal versus static roof, to be able to identify where need was. There was no convolutional neural network behind that. They were looking at the roofs and seeing where the need was. I'm assuming that this Africa Cube that you've mentioned, since the raw data was available, was really a bit of engineering that you had to do,
mm-hmm.
and a relatively nice UI and some training.
Yeah.
So it was not a lot of money to actually be able to make an impact.
Mm-hmm.
I think somebody's got to take the lead in any one of these problems and say, okay, I'm going to go ahead and make that impact. I mean, if you step back from data, you know, the Gates Foundation, you know, has made a huge impact on the health front, you know, by investing in nets, you know, against malaria. So I mean, it's. I think that there are impacts that can happen. With Silicon Valley is going to continue to invest in self-driving cars, right? You know, and then they'll have some foundation on the side. But if we sort of ignore that for a bit and say, okay, there's data available that doesn't require huge sophistication to be leveraged for social good. I think that there's a lot of opportunities. I was a little rude to both speakers because I was constantly on my phone trying to get some information. And this is the most dead zone organ that I've ever found. So it's completely dead. So my information on the next thing I'm going to mention is going to be out of date. So please forgive me. But there was an app that I learned about 3 years ago, 2 or 3 years ago, called Ushahidi, which means in Swahili means proof or evidence. And they used very simple mobile phone data to mobilize where resources are needed in the event of a natural disaster. There was no learning there. They just basically saw the traffic where it was most needed. I know they still exist because I was able to see that the web page was there, but I couldn't bring it up. So I don't know what they're working on right now. But you know, I think that there are things that can be done in terms of matching supply with demand that don't require, you know, a moonshot plan for 20 years.
Could you spell the name, please?
Ushahidi.
Ushahidi. Yeah, I just wanted to add one thing about financing that I just remembered, which is, I mean, one of the things that we try to do in the partnership is very much to kind of raise the political profile of data and to break out of the kind of technical conversation and make data more of a political conversation, exactly on this topic around investments, around, you know, what's needed. And the one thing that I think I have learned painfully in the last 2 years of trying to do that is that if you're trying to get politicians to care about data, to invest money in it, to do whatever, the absolute last thing you want to do is talk about the data. But what you do is you tell them how making that investment is going to help to improve health services or improve education. And data, I think, you know, it's absolutely the means to the end. And I think that's, and some, you know, for us, often data is the end point, because that's the bit of the sort of chain that we're concerned with. But I think when it gets to these questions about financing, again, which are political, about where people choose to put their resources, you have to remember it's not actually about the data at all.
Thanks. So as a former economist, now turned to data scientist, I have a question. I mean, it's a broad one. Data could be considered as a relatively weird kind of a good. It's not even a commodity, and it's not a financial instrument. It's something really slick away, or like a particle. And in that case, I just wanted to ask, regarding the newest regulations, which are set upon from the private sector as well from the government side, what could be the future of the data markets? Will it be a global data market seen as like we see today in the financial sector, or maybe something even more centralized in the opposite states? For example, I would my opinion would be China would never allow this like a direct trade-off between the data of its own citizens between them and for example the United Kingdom. Would it also lead to a new tariff war or maybe a new some kind of a data trading war? And what are the opinions regarding that? I'm not even sure about it.
That's so interesting. There was a really interesting article in the Financial Times actually a few weeks ago about that point of sort of data in trade, by somebody who used to be the FT's trade correspondent, talking about data as a sort of traded commodity and speculating a little bit exactly on those lines. I really recommend it. It was fascinating. I think this is such an interesting question. I don't think there is any consensus about what data is. You know, I was saying about how much I hate the analogy of data is the new oil, but I think it serves a purpose because we don't know. You know, I once did a sort of Twitter, I put a question on Twitter and said, you know, what do people think data is? And I got about 5 or 6 different, very different sort of models, you know, lots of replies, but they kind of fell into very different categories. You know, is it infrastructure? Is it like the roads and the railways? Is it water? Is it like a sort of public good that flows? And is it like oil, something that we want to kind of own and control and make money, you know, and many other things besides. So I think that is one of the things which is making the public conversation about data and regulation so difficult. We don't know what it is. And we also don't really know who owns it, which is to some extent a function of the same thing. You know, so the sort of your kind of data companies are behaving as if they own it. And then, like Facebook, they're getting into trouble with that when suddenly they're overstepping the boundary. In the UK, the government have just passed a legislation where they've made it a requirement for some companies to share some data with the government for public, you know, not for surveillance particularly, well, who knows what may happen in the future, but the moment, you know, very much on the sort of public good ends. This is things that, in the UK again, in our National Health Service, a very sensible, not very big reform of the data management within the National Health Service, which would have probably made life much easier for researchers and doctors, was squashed because of a huge privacy campaign by a small number of campaigns, you know, and a real fears about that. So I think that is exactly the question. I think not many people are asking it, but the reason, but the fact that we don't have an answer, I think, is a huge barrier to trying to do anything sensible on data policy.
Actually, my opinion was it's like a mixture of two things. It's intangible on one hand. Mm-hmm. It could be multiplied. So really that problematic. Then again, insurance companies could be actually the demanders for information and data like that, raw data like that. Mm-hmm. Could actually just borrow it for approximately a short period of time, as if the museums or the galleries would rent out artworks.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
I mean, who owns the gates of the gates of Ishtar? Does it really belong to the Berlin Museum? Or does it belong to the Iraqi Republic? Or does it belong to the common good of the common mankind? It's really, really all on that level. But somehow the Berlin Museum and the city of Berlin profits from it.
You mentioned something in your talk that I really like, which is, of course, the topic is data has been for a while with us, but the impact is relatively new and the potentiality is relatively new, less than 5 to 6 years. And of course, there are tough questions, tough without any precise answer, but it's part of the conversation to build the social contract that we want to have regarding data. Based on our conversations, we could build our future. If we don't have these kind of conversations, even we don't have a precise answer right now, we will never go to the right direction what we want to build. So, it's, yeah. As, what she said, there is not a precise question, it's still open, but it's great that we start that we are having the conversation and start defining some things. There were a question here?
I'm a sociologist, so I have a different view on data. For me, and I think that's always because I think you, most guys of you, are very, very technical. And for me, as a sociologist, data is just a representation of the real world.
Mm-hmm.
I think that gets forgotten all the time.
Yeah.
And so for me as a sociologist, it's like, I want to know what an NGO needs. So I would come up with a research design, go ask them, produce the data in a way that I can handle it afterwards, and then analyze it. And for me, I always have a feeling that NGOs don't know the rich data set that they already have. But if you cannot help them to get it out of them, it's our problem, and it's not the problem of the NGO. Mm-hmm. So I guess my question is that any concern, or is it in, because I'm always missing that part. If you want to know something about the world, go and get the stuff you need to say something about the world.
Mm-hmm.
So, I guess there's no real question here.
I think we're more diverse on the panel than you think. Some of us are technical. But I also would say that, you know, my immediate reaction is, I think that's exactly what Rania and Frederick and Chris are trying to do, which is,
exactly
what is it that you need, and let's start a conversation so we can figure out how to get what you need and get some answers.
But my point is, as a sociologist, I think people don't know what they need, so we need to help them find out what they need.
The unknown unknowns.
I want to hear Nicole's insight on this, and Thomas, I don't see him, but there is a, I don't see him in the audience, if it's Thomas here, there is a data scientist that is also a sociologist, and it's interesting because exactly what you described is the process of a data scientist at the beginning, how you start with the question, you go into the details and that. Let's hear Nicole's insight from your experience working in an NGO with data, and and we could just...
I think I can totally relate to what you're saying, because also from our work with NGOs, but also from my experience in this datathon, it's extremely hard to express what you really need and to express the real question and then formulate it in a way that you can answer it with the data that you have. So what our experience, and then you have like the language problem again. It's like there are so many challenges that you face in the very beginning before even getting to the point where you like talk about data sources and where to get the data and all that stuff. But it's like defining the problem and really coming to this small problem or a small question that you want to answer. Because what we did, and where I think the next time that you would involve in such a process, is like reframing the questions, and we would have to work like even harder on defining the question, because they were so broad that within this short period of time that people were working with different data, they like came up with so many directions in which you could answer that question. So it was like, okay, they were super broad, the questions. And then, our main goal was very broad as well. So it's like one led to the other in a way. And finding the common language, or a language that's kind of, not common, it doesn't have to be common, but at least similar, that was also very challenging. And then I think that's always very challenging when different worlds come together. And it's, I think, like, if all of you work with like companies, maybe companies or nonprofits or academia, it's like they're totally different terms for maybe the same or similar things, or there are different definitions between the same terms that you use. So that's a huge challenge. It's not impossible to solve it, but it takes time.
Yeah, I guess my point was, we sociologists already have so many tools to be really precise on. We want to know the answer to this question, but we have so many tools to ask exactly what we want. And I think it also is my feeling that this is a blind spot. It's tough work, but
the blind spot for the, it's not for the sociologists, but for the NGOs, or
no, for like. How to answer questions about the world, and that there's a whole profession that is not on the radar for like whoever that's a thing. Yeah. I guess we're just all interested in the world. So,
Frederick, how was your experience in the Data for Good program?
Yeah, I'm just thinking and I'm relating back to you, because I think you said like data is nothing new, and I also think this relating back to your comment, this mismatch in business people or the NGO people speak a different language than the tech people. It's also nothing new. It's something that always happens when new technologies come here. I'm just wondering, what is the urgency now? And to some extent, I have the impression, like, as we live in such an accelerating world, and we have AI, machine learning, data science, making these rapid advances in private sector, I think there my personal urgency is coming from, like, trying to want to share these kind of new exciting tools. And yes, it's only new tools, it's not like it's not radical new, it's like exciting new tools with people who don't know nothing about it. So it's a conversation to share. It's not radically new, and these hackathons are another nice way of doing this, but there should be many other ways as well.
I need to add something now.
Yes,
why is it so relevant now, or so acute? No, is that not English?
Yeah.
No, like, because we are at a point where we may lose a war for democracy, for who owns information,
mm-hmm.
who can make money of it, who can, say in which direction we go with it, and who can profit from it. So the internet, and it's much broader than data itself, we lose democracy in the internet, and we lose democracy with data, and we lose it also in the democracy in this process. And this is what's happening now, and this is why it's so urgent now. Yeah.
I disagree a little bit, but on others, I disagree in the sense that I don't see or feel that we lose democracy due to data. I see it more in a broader picture, like information technology, and this data we talk about is like part of this, is another wave of technological revolutions, like many before. And in all of these revolutions, there are all these distortions of people who are more rapid to grab the advantages and others who take longer. And we are right now in this phase where it's not completely clear what is going to happen in the end. But where I disagree is I have a large optimism. although I completely agree that, like, very recently there were lots of examples where it went into the wrong direction.
Please, before going into this direction, which is extremely interesting, I just want to close this point. Yes, of course, there is a challenge. Please welcome to join if you want.
Mm-hmm.
It's something that was included in the design that was made by Chris, Frederick, and Rania, is that there is time between defining the project and going to the dataton. So all the challenges that Nicole mentioned, that is, well, they are a reality, there are different worlds talking together, there is enough time to really have the talk, prepare the data, and so on, before going to the weekend. Is that the solve for everything? No, but it's exactly the experience of bringing all the worlds together, and by the way, that is exactly the same that in the private company that the scientists are dealing with, because it's so many languages at the same time switching, it's part of the skills that needs are done. Thanks for the question. So coming back to this one.
I'm not a huge optimist as you were, I'm a small optimist. I would say actually on two different points. One is, sociologists can participate. I would say there's been a change in the UN. I worked in the public sector, international public sector, for 8.5 years, my only experience doing it. And the UN as a whole at least talks the talk of outcomes and impact. They didn't do that 15 years ago, right? They talked about how can we spend our money, but now they talk about, what's the impact, what's the outcome? Different UN organizations do it better or worse. I would imagine your organization is helping those with the UN itself sort of keep that promise. But at least, at least that's sort of the talk that major foundations and the UN are doing as well. And I would agree with you, liberal democracy is at huge risk, but I would agree with Claire here that government is part of the solution. And to the extent that the European Union still exists as a body that can make decisions, this GDPR law is actually a huge deal. Because it's probably the first time that supranational government, you know, more than a single government in a single country, has been able to basically say, hold on, Silicon Valley, you know what? This is our data. You know, this is our stuff. And it's it has a huge impact because, or it could have a huge impact, because the fines are not minor. You know, to the extent that you know, Facebook and the other social media companies don't do the right thing, or at least more of the right thing, it just puts power back in the hands of people to say, okay, this is my data. That's necessary but not sufficient, because then there has to be an independent news media, there can't be lying leaders in government. I mean, there's all sorts of things that make me only a small optimist, but I think that governments can have an impact. And again, I don't think this has anything to do with AI techniques. You know, I'm old enough, I've got gray enough beard here. I've sort of seen this all go around. We've been doing this every 30 years, you know, this is, and we've made huge progress in very narrow domains in vision processing. But it's not like we know how to have a social impact, you know, to, you know, alleviate poverty. That's not gonna happen through AI and data science. It's gonna happen from nuts and bolts, providing what's needed for people. That's my view.
I think the huge paradigm shift we have is we have a shift from human-readable data to machine-readable data. Because one of the biggest problems I have a library system which is super human-readable. Yeah, every human understands what's an author. But taking this data and put it into a format that Google can understand is a huge challenge. And the second problem is you have data. Now, all the new data is only machine-readable. Now, that's machine-readable raw data. And if you don't have an application or have the right interface or can access the data with my phone, then you don't have any access to the data. That's the democratic difficulty we have, is we have the data, but you have a lot of the data in machine-readable form. And without the tools and the infrastructure to really access the data once again in a human accessible form, the data don't exist for 99% of the population.
I don't want to dominate, but I have an answer. I don't agree with you with that. Okay. I mean, I think that's actually where I'll put my technical hat on. You know, XML and JSON formats are both human readable and machine readable, right? You know, the ability to actually look at data that a machine can understand and actually understand I'm involved in another startup. I'm co-founded another startup, which is for language translation. So in Austria and Germany, there was this huge wave of migrants that came in 2015, and a lot of people need to learn German. And it turned out there's this resource called Television that people can use to learn another language. And these television programs are subtitled. It was relatively easy for us to take these subtitles, which were in a machine-readable form, and turn them into something that could be used in the subtitles had to exist for people that were hearing impaired, but we were able to use them, feed them through a machine translation program, and now you can watch, you know, your television program, see the subtitles in German, be able to click on a word and see it in whatever language you want, and you can learn the language faster. I actually think it has been a revolution. It used to be there was binary code, and then there was stuff that people could understand. And now it's not that hard to write applications that are both human readable and machine readable. That's been my experience.
There were a question over here. No? Okay, perfect. Please go
ahead. Perhaps a comment regarding the political issues regarding big data. I think in past times we've been accustomed that decisions about people have been taken by people, but we now move into a time where decisions are taken by machines, by algorithms, and we please ourselves to name them intelligent, but what they actually are, it's just the statistics. It's not intelligence, it's just mathematics. So if you put bias or wrong data in, you get wrong decisions out. And what I'm really afraid of is that things like in the justice department, decisions about parole or something, are taken by machines based on biased data. And if we look to China with their social credit system and so on, I think this is something that scares me. And it's a way to use data in an unfair, in a biased way, and by calling it artificial intelligence, it gets a modern touch.
May I give you another view on that? And I agree with you. We know that you said about the legal system. Do you know that judges, so if you are for something, I don't know, victim or something like that, or accused of, and you are accused of, let's say, the morning, it's bad for you. If you're accused in the afternoon by a human judge, that's good for you. This is proven in sense of quite a large data set, and humans did that. And a lot of people who saw that, and it's in the book, Thinking Fast and Slow, maybe somebody has read it, just quoting here, then we accept it. Because we say, yeah, on the morning I'm also quite...
But there's the possibility to appeal, to go to another human being and
yeah.
have a look. If you put the same data into the same algorithm, it will give you the same answer.
My point is, in a very short amount of time, let's go to, I don't know, autonomous driving, okay? In a very short amount of time, it will be very easily proven that the amount of miles an autonomous car will do without an accident will be much higher than what a human can do. But I would doubt that this is enough for us, because there was one woman now killed by Uber. And when you read some of the comments there, it was like, it's a machine. There isn't any error allowed.
Yeah.
So I think in our judgment, how we judge errors, we are different in sense of if a human or a machine is doing it there. And you're completely right. If it's learning on biased data, well, it makes the same bullshit than we are doing.
Yeah, but the racist judge is still responsible for being racist.
Yeah.
Who's responsible? Is Uber responsible?
It's a very good and unanswered question.
The main point here, you're absolutely right, and that's one of the main ethics conversations on the field. One of the dangerous side is that normally, because it's artificial intelligence is always right, and that's wrong. But bringing this conversation that not because the computer says so it's right, it's one of the first steps. I think Chris has a upcoming a knowledge bit on the matter of eventually. But basically on exactly the bias when you are programming, and part where we are approaching the diversity on the profession is every human being has bias, and when you are programming an algorithm, you are bringing your bias to the algorithm. But if just a small part of the population is doing the algorithms, so you are going to have the bias of this small part that are creating the algorithms. If you have a more diverse profession, then it's easier to include.
Actually, I just wanted to respond to this also. Part of the motivation in starting a program like Data for Good is that AI has an impact, and if we deal with it from the standpoint of ignorance, I don't know how it works, it becomes a black or white kind of tool. Either it's great and it can do miracles, or it is evil, and it is neither. It's a tool, it depends on how you use it. You can use it for bad, you can use it for good. Let's start the conversation so that we can, all of us together, figure out how we want to use it. And not from the point of ignorance, but from the point of we've talked to each other and decided together where we're going to go with it. So.
I like the conversation very much. And I work for the EU Agency for Fundamental Rights, and we recently published a paper on exactly this topic, on this bias in automated decision making, not only automated decision making. I also like the comment because I also think we should see the GDPR as an advantage, because it provides, it's a good tool. But one of the problems is, of course, that it also only forbids automated decision making. And if you have a judge getting like risk scores, then of course the judge is also influenced, and we can still be a problem. So I also think it's the advantage if we have this regulation in Europe, because if the data are misused, then people lose the trust in the data and will not share the data anymore. That's a big problem. But then I would not use Google anymore if I know it's misused, the data. So my question to the panel would also be, I mean, what's your opinion, and also especially beyond Europe, I mean, what type of regulation would we need?
Mm-hmm. Before answering this question, you have also a comment, right? And
I lost my concentration now because I listened.
Okay, if you remember. Great. So, whenever you remember, you can just.
Yeah.
Okay. So, real regulations, what are your.
Oh, sorry, yeah, I know.
Go, go.
One really important point, in my view, is, and it's also often forgotten in the discussions, you know. Mistakes that are made by people can be judged by people, but mistakes that that need a lot of understanding to even know if there is a mistake there or not needs, in this case, data literacy. And we don't have programs to learn people to understand what's happening. So I think if we talk about all this stuff, it's very important to also talk about how can we bring with us all the people that need to be able to understand what's happening. Mm-hmm. And yeah, that's mm-hmm. something that, yeah, I miss this in these discussions a lot.
Absolutely. So any questions regarding the regulation and the part of understanding the why an algorithm comes with a precise answer?
Things. I mean, I think the point about the algorithms is really important, and I think there's this sort of mystique. I think this conversation about sort of, you know, you have bias, you have bad decisions being made by people, you have bad decisions being made by machines, and there's somehow an assumption that we find it easier to challenge a decision which is made by a person than a decision which is made by a machine. And I think that's the thing that we need to, I mean, we need to build better algorithms, but that's also the thing that we need to challenge. If your hypothetical algorithm judge is producing kind of systematically racist outcomes, you'd know that. You know, you'd see the sentencing record and you'd think, as you would with the human judge, hang on a minute, that doesn't look fair. And I think what we need, and this comes to the data literacy point, is the sort of confidence to say, I may not understand, I may not be able to build an algorithm, but I know an unfair outcome when I see one. And it makes no difference whether it's, you know, there's no mystique about, you know, we have this sort of mystique about all data, it comes out of a computer, it must be right. Yeah, and I think that's the bit to challenge, is that an algorithm is built by a person, it's got the same biases, it's got, you know, it's affected by how good is the data that goes in, how good is the algorithm, you know, that's, and I think that's, I mean, that's very much linked to data literacy, but it's not so much actually, it's partly about people actually knowing how to do it, but it's also about sort of demystifying the whole thing a little bit and making people as willing to challenge data and algorithms as they are to challenge people. And just one other different point on this thing about regulation. I mean, I do think it's really important, and I think, of course, you know, historically, seems likely that, you know, you're going to get that sort of the EU and others are going to be pioneering the regulation, and then other countries will follow. But I do have in the back of my head all the time a sort of, you know, times when that's given us really horrendous outcomes. I mean, the one that I always come back to is the sort of rules around drug testing, and the way in which, when in Europe and America, the, you know, rules around testing drugs on human beings were tightened up. So what did the drugs companies do? They went and tested out on populations in Africa where there was, you know, very much less regulation. I hope that we can't do as much damage with data as we can with dodgy drugs, but I think that the principle is still the same. You know, as you regulate in the GDPR, you create a bit of an inequality. And I already see people going in and doing kind of big data experiments with cool data records and things in African countries. That, you know, it all seems really exciting, and they're doing it from the best of motives, and, you know, they're coming out with things that are genuinely useful, but they're only able to do that because there's no regulation. And I do think that will come back to bite us in the end.
Yeah, I had a couple comments. One was from the consumer side, I would completely agree with you that, you know, the lack of civics education, you know, people actually having the ability to critically think about the information that's being presented and voting appropriately, at least in the U.S., you know, has had a disastrous outcome. You know, there's a political solution for that and an educational solution, but there has to be the will to do that. One of the sources of another source of helping us with that are journalists that are data literate. You know, and there's, you know, a class of journalists now that they do exactly that. They look at automated sentencing outcomes and say, hey, you know, this is not equivalent. You know, this is not equivalent. Another example was the differential sentencing of people that were convicted of crack cocaine possession versus powdered cocaine, and it was completely a white-black issue. You know, so I think data science literate journalists required in a liberal democracy can help. The third piece, though, is actually the technical people in the room have a responsibility. Again, wearing my grandfather hat here. 30 years ago, the state of the art in artificial intelligence was not, it's not just biased data, it's that the algorithms that have been created that are the best in vision processing, for instance, are not algorithms. What's not kept pace is the ability to assign credit or blame for the decisions that are being made. You've got a convolutional neural network that's 30 layers deep. And if you ask the people that have actually written the algorithms, okay, why did it make this decision here? They don't have an answer, right? It's the mathematics said this was the best and we trained the network. 30 years ago, AI systems were people writing rules like, if X happens, then Y. And so when things went bad, you could point to the bad rule or the conflicting rule. And we don't have the same level of sophistication in AI now to explain the decisions that are being made that we did 30 years ago. It's not that the algorithms haven't gotten better, they have, but there is no real pointing at, oh, this is what's not right. So when a self-driving car crashes, and it's happened more than once, it's happened quite a few times, it happened with Tesla, I mean, you know, there's, you know, when it happens, it's not that somebody's blinded by the sun and you can sort of point to that. They have to go back and they have to tweak the numerical algorithms so that it doesn't happen again, but it's really, really hard for them to say this was the cause. So the public is right to be skeptical of using sophisticated AI algorithms to control aspects of our life. I think that these algorithms can be hugely helpful in a place where life and death is not decided, you know, by the algorithm, but that doesn't mean that the supply side here has gotten it right. They haven't gotten it right. You know, the news media plays it up, but they haven't gotten it right yet.
May I step in here, because this is actually something quite interesting in my opinion, because it's about black box algorithms. But basically, you don't know why this decision is made. And my maybe a bit provocative question, maybe, why do we care?
Because wait, buy it.
Yes, but also if a drunk one basically kills three people here on.
Yeah, but
on
we have millennia of experience.
Please let me finish.
Sorry.
So then we say, well, are we going then back and say, well, he had a very bad childhood, and 30 years ago, his kindergarten aunt actually hit him one time, and that's why he...
We do that.
Yeah, do we that?
The sentencing can be reduced if there's reason for reducing.
Okay. So we are reducing then the sentence for the algorithm.
The thing is, we have millennia of experience people killing people, we are used to this. We know
exactly. How to do it. We can basically say, yeah, I can understand why I killed
him. we have really sophisticated systems to go about that and to punish people, and should we punish them? How much? Who do you punish?
So actually,
when the machine kills them,
for you, it's moral question, and sense you have to punish something.
Yeah.
You can't accept then that it's maybe an accident.
Of course, you don't go to jail. Jail if it's an accident.
Yeah, okay. The legal system has.
In a philosophical way, here lies a real, real deep problem with
yes,
that.
Yes, exactly.
When they stop
I try to ask that.
Telling.
I don't have an answer, of course. If I would have an answer, it wouldn't be honest.
I don't want to.
I
think it's time to wrap up. We have refreshments here where we could continue the conversations more in a one-on-one way. So I want to invite our panelists. First, thanks. I want to invite all of our panelists for a closing remark. Then I just want conclusion, and we could continue the conversation, especially this one, with some refreshments here. So please, Frederick.
Yeah, thanks for having me. Great discussion to have. And again, a little piece of what I want to conclude with is to spread information of what's possible, not the big splash, but through nuts and bolts, and hopefully many interesting small projects and form hackathons and similar.
Yeah, thanks, Mari, for inviting me on the panel. Thanks, Claire, for the keynote. I remain a small optimist, and I think I'm very excited by the initiative that the three of you have pushed for, and I think we actually learned that, you know, any such team maybe should have a sociologist on it. I look forward to NGOs actually raising their hand and saying, look, you know, I have this issue, you know, can you help me?
Yeah, thank you. Really great discussion and really enjoyed it. So yeah, thank you. Good luck to you all and stay in touch.
Thanks for inviting me and giving me the opportunity to dive into your community, actually. And I think we stay curious and we want to know more.
And we want to learn as well from your experience, which is great in terms of the insights.
I want to thank the Vienna Data Science Group for the leadership of actually reaching out, because my closing remark would be that's the first step. So what I've seen is that working with a lot of these really small-scale NGOs and social businesses, they're often really excited about the support that someone offers, but then they also get overwhelmed because, you know, they have so many problems they need to deal with, and if you introduce them with a tool like, you know, being able to understand the world better, might end up overwhelming them. So I think it's also about like understanding that world and not coming and kind of just being like, it would be really cool to apply this thing that you totally don't need or don't have the capacity to use. But I think this is the right approach, and so good luck with the project, and we're there to support, and keep this up. So thanks for the invitation.
Thanks a lot. Basically, just wrapping up the whole event, the whole community and the whole audience is very mixed, quite not just technical, believe me. We know more or less who are from our community. It's very mixed. Of course, the ethical part is probably one that it's normally getting a lot of attention, especially because of the news, and because we are right to be skeptical and worry about the whole spectrum, about the whole infrastructure. Having said that, that doesn't mean that it's just to be worried. It's a wonderful tool. Private sector is gaining a lot of insight because of this, and there are plenty of tools that are not dangerous in terms of the ethical side and could be applied in NGOs, and there are the skills here to work on that and really bring the different communities. Yes, there are some challenges regarding the language, regarding even exploring, okay, if we go in this direction, are we having some ethical issues? But we could always have the conversation and find a middle point that makes sense for all the parties. And that's the idea with the Data for Good program. It's the idea why the Vienna Data Science Group is a non-for-profit or officially a FRIN, and bringing these conversations, which are not just technical, it also cover everything. So even if this is not a fairy tale, we want to bring the whole topic. It is possible to do very interesting things with the data, and it's up to us how we talk with each other and how we use these tools to really make a data for good impact and not in the other way. So please, we keep in touch. There are some refreshments there. We could continue this very interesting topic and conversation. And thanks for joining us today.